Guys, today, this interview right here is absolute fire. Okay, Jeremy Lee Miner is, this guy is an amazing salesperson. And we really get into why he's such a great salesperson. It's his background, okay, what he studied. It's really amazing. And so we get into that in the beginning, a little bit of his story, a little bit of his background, which is, for me, very interesting. I mean, I was very interested, you know, doing the interview, listening to his background and everything. And then we get into some scripts. Now, the script that he's going to run through here is, I've never heard this strategy. And I would fear to say you have not heard this strategy. And I have to say, I really like this strategy. He also just, boom, lays down this incredible voicemail script that will get people calling you back. You know, my voicemail script is more so, you know, more of a brand builder. I'm just trying to, you know, let the prospect hear my name, hear my voice, company I'm with. I'm just trying to use it as another piece of the personal branding puzzle so that they hear me and know what I do. And then they see me online and then they see my signs around town and they see a postcard, they see my email, whatever it is. But he lays down a voicemail script that there's no doubt he's going to get a lot of callbacks from this. So this is going to be an interview you want to watch all the way because it's just that good. So anyway, shoot me a comment. Let me know what you think. Let me know if you have any questions for Jeremy. I can reach out to him directly. And smash that like button. I mean, I'm out here grinding my face off for you. And I think you're really going to enjoy this. So let's get right into it.
But he said the people who fail, the ones who do not do as well, is because they were not taught the right skills. Basically, what that told me in my mind is what they were really saying to me is that what we're training you doesn't really work that well. So you're just gonna have to work harder and work more hours. So I'm like, that's not really fair to me. I bought your training. You're saying I just need to work hard. Like, what do I need to say on that call? So the biggest thing we have to do is we have to trigger enough curiosity that causes the prospect on the other side of the phone to actually want to engage. You should not ask confused on a cold call. You gotta show them that you're in charge and that you're an expert. And I'm like, I agree.
Because agents will say, I've been making calls. I've been making calls months and months and months, you know, and I've got nothing. I'm like, well, it's not the people you're calling. All right, it's you. Like, we have to work on your tone and your delivery and your communication. Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to the show. Today, I've got what some people regard as the greatest salesperson on the face of the planet. If you're watching this, I'm sure you've seen his social media ads all over the place, as I have. So, Mr. Jeremy Lee Miner, what's up, bro?
Ricky, I have not heard that, but that's a very nice compliment. We'll let our clients and fans do the talking. That's not up for me to say for sure, but it was a very, very nice introduction. My kids always say I'm boring, so I'm going to take that as a compliment.
Well, like I said, as some people regard, I saw that on a couple of YouTubes, like the title, like greatest salesperson on earth.
Who knows?
Or whatever.
I don't know if there's any official rankings on that. So we'll let everybody debate that one day down the road. Yeah. Maybe when I'm 85.
So, bro, I love your stuff. And what I've seen, my sales background and my sales style is very relationship oriented, right? I come from a place of real serious, genuine curiosity, if you will. You know, that's my style. I like to try to figure out what I can do to help the prospect using my services, you know, that kind of thing. I get the impression that you have a lot of that within your style of sales. Is that, am I right on there?
I mean, a lot of people would say that. I mean, in my view, we're probably like a bit different than most sales training organizations would train you how to sell. We view selling as more like collaborative, like you working with the prospect to help them, you know, find and solve problems that maybe they didn't really understand they have, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas most sales training, not all, I'm not saying that, but most sales training that you're going to see out there that I've went through in the last 23 years is more adversarial. Maybe you against the prospect trying to win them over so you can make money. And I would say, like, you know, that's what average salespeople do in our day and age. So you don't want to be average. If you want to be in the top 1%, you have to think differently of what selling even really is. Because when you understand it from kind of what I'm talking about, that it's more of a collaborative process. Now, that doesn't mean you get to the end of the sales conversation or conversations and you say, well, if you're interested, email me back. I mean, that's obviously not going to get you far in the sales profession either. But, you know, we have to understand how to get the prospect first and foremost to let their guard down, where they become open to even answering the questions we have. You know, and I see a lot of salespeople that have good questions. They don't really know how to use like their tone and different things to get the prospect to even open up and actually go below the surface when they ask a question. They stay surface level, which is not a good place you want to be as a sales professional in any industry. You know, in the industry you're talking to, mainly real estate, we train thousands of real estate agents. Definitely you want people to open up for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's my big thing is tone, right? Right in the front end. Try to create this situation, this vibe that it's like, oh crap, who is this? As in not who the hell is this, but man, do I know this person? This sounds familiar. Is this a friend, a family, or somebody, a long lost high school buddy or something like that? Who is this calling me? That's the kind of feeling I like to give off. I want to get into the sales stuff. I know we have, you know, limited time. I don't really know the Jeremy Lee Miner story, bro.
What would you like to know?
Dude, I want to know just like the quick synopsis of like how you came to be.
Yeah. So I'll give you the 2 minute overview if that's what you want. Because, you know, so I got started in selling, 22 years ago. Yeah, 2001 as a broke, I would say burned out college kid. I was my junior going into my senior year of college. And I got invited to like this recruiting meeting. Okay. So I went to school out in Utah. So if you're familiar, it's like very fertile ground to recruit door-to-door salespeople from college, right? Because a lot of us go on what are called LDS church missions for 2 years and rather knocking doors and being crazy and stuff. And so I was out there with a bunch of my friends going to school. And I remember one of my roommates literally came in and was like, hey, there's this meeting. You can make all this money and there's free food or like free pizza. And as a broke college student, I took the bait, went to get the free pizza. And there's probably, you know, 70, 80 people in the room and they're up there, you know, going over how you can make all this money selling door to door. And their whole, I don't like to say pitch. I hate that word. It's weird, but like their presentation was all about, hey, you can work 3 months in the summer, June, July, August, you know, May, June, July, August, you're going to make enough money in the summer where you don't have to work at these dead end jobs while you go to college. You can just focus on your grades. And it's actually real. It's a real industry. And so I'm like, that makes sense. If I can work hard this summer, make a bunch of money, I can focus on school. Okay. And my major was behavioral science and social dynamics, which is really the study of the brain and how human beings make decisions, which I probably have a competitive advantage because I understand how the brain says yes or no and what to trigger things. So, but they don't teach sales in that, if that makes sense. It's more theory. So anyway, so I get the job, they hire everybody there because it's straight commission. So if it doesn't work out, no, you know, no big deal. Right. And so they shipped us all off to different cities in the United States for that summer. And I was selling alarm systems. Okay. So I remember, you know, going out, they take you out in a van in the middle of these neighborhoods and they basically kick you out of the van, right. Around noon, one in the afternoon. And they're like, hey, go make some sales. You know, it's going to be easy. We'll pick you up after dark. You know, and they give you like a little script you got to memorize, right? Like a door approach. And they give you a few books from what I call the, you know, the old sales gurus. And that's it. Like you're there.
Wild, man.
Yeah, this is the real deal, right? So I still remember, this is interesting. I had a feeling you were going to ask me about this. And so I remember getting dropped off. I was the last one. And I remember looking back really nervous and excited. Okay. My manager looked at me. His name was Xane. This crazy name, Xane. Had curly blonde hair. And I still remember him saying, Jeremy, remember when they open up the door, show them how excited you are about the product. Show them that you believe in it, that you're enthusiastic about it. and they're going to be excited about it and they're going to invite you in. And, you know, what would I know? I never sold anything. I was 21. So I'm like, okay, if I'm excited in it, then somehow magically they're going to be excited. I didn't know. So I started knocking on doors and started talking about the features and benefits and how great the company was. And we were the number one this and the number one that, and it was going to be so beneficial. And I started noticing from the very first door, I was getting all these objections. We don't need it. Your price is too high. We already talked with somebody from your company. We got a dog. We got a gun. We can't afford it. It's too expensive. I need to think it over. I need to talk with my spouse. We need to do more research. You know, can you call me back a week, a month, a year later? And I think everybody on here has probably heard some of those objections before. And so I remember about 7 to 8 weeks in of that like nonstop rejection, barely making any sales. And when you're straight commission, when you don't make any sales, you don't make any money, right? And so I remember standing on a curve one late, I think it was a Friday or Saturday evening, waiting to get picked up the end of the week, okay? And I remember I'd work like 12, 13 hours that day, sweat like drenching down my chest. You're selling in the middle of summer. Imagine how humid it is. Think Alabama humidity, okay? Mm-hmm. Sweat's dripping down your chest, you know, your back. I still remember my legs were like jello. If you ever sold door-to-door, you know what I mean by that, okay? You're just exhausted. And I remember I'd made zero sales that day. So I made $0. And I, in fact, that whole week I'd made zero sales. So I'd made $0 after a 5 or 6 day work week. Okay. $0. All right. And I remember sitting there thinking, you know, maybe selling just wasn't for me. I remember that going out of my mind. Okay. And I remember the manager picked me up and he popped in a Tony Robbins CD of all CDs. And yes, I know that, you know, 22 years ago, people would listen to these like round things, these magical things called CDs, right? Mm-hmm. And so he popped in Tony, and I'd never heard of him before. And Tony said something like this, and I might be butchering it, but he said, you will fail. Like I said, I might be butchering it, Tony, if you're listening. You will fail if you don't learn the right skills necessary to succeed. You will fail if you don't learn the right skills necessary to succeed. And he went on to say, I thought it was interesting, that everyone is taught skills. But he said the people who fail, the ones who do not do as well, is because they were not taught the right skills. And he talks about there's different skill levels in each profession. And a lot of people just don't get taught at the highest level. And it was like, when I heard him say that, it was like this maybe light bulb moment went off in my head, almost like divine intervention from the heavens, the sales gods, that maybe what the company was training me and what I was learning from the quote unquote sales gurus, maybe they just weren't the right skills. Maybe they were just maybe outdated, didn't work as well anymore. So what I did at that time that I had this kind of like epiphany is, you know, I'm going to school here, taking behavioral science, human psychology, study the brain, and how human beings make decisions. And my college professors, one of them was by the name of Robert Cialdini. Are you familiar with Robert Cialdini?
Robert Cialdini, it rings a bell.
So he's the head of behavioral science at Arizona State University. So he's got books like best-selling books called Persuasion, Influence. I mean, he's been around for 30 plus years, right?
Yeah.
And so my professors, so I was taking online courses as well there. My professors were saying that the most effective way to communicate was here. But when I read books from the sales gurus, they were saying it was here. So we're talking kind of like opposite viewpoints. And so I'm like, how do I take what I'm learning from like human behavior, human psychology, social dynamics? How do I take that theory? Because it wasn't like they were teaching like, here's the right questions to ask. Here's how to use your tone. Here's how to shift your body language this way instead of that. That really wasn't taught in behavioral science classes in college. So I'm like, how do I take that theory and how do I wrap that into a sales process at the time that I was selling, right? Because what I was doing wasn't working that well. So how do I get my prospects to do all the work? How do I get my prospects to, you know, sell themselves? How do I get my prospects to overcome their own objections? And how do I get them to pull me in? Whereas before I was being taught by the gurus that I needed to do all the work. I needed to do all the convincing. I needed to do all the persuading, all the chasing. I needed to throw out rebuttals to their objections. And I needed to push and pressure, which, as we all know, doesn't really work that well unless you like playing the numbers game. right? Mm-hmm. And so that's what I did. I started taking those, you know, how do I work with human behavior? I started wrapping him to the right questions, the right time, the right tone, and a lot of other things. And overnight, selling became very, very easy and, you know, extremely profitable. Within 4 years from that, I was making multiple seven figures a year in commissions. I just got into like a different job at that point.
And so not in the same business?
Well, in that business, I got up to about $100,000 a month in commissions, mm-hmm. but you only work 4 months out of the year because you work in the
And this was what year?
This would have been in like 2001, 2002, okay. 2003, 2004.
You're $100,000 a month selling alarm systems is yeah. pretty serious.
Well, yeah, for sure. Back in those days, nobody made a third of that, right? So yeah. I was like, how do you do that? And then, so that.
So obviously you were like the number one salesperson in the company at that point, huh?
In the industry, yeah.
Yeah.
In the United States, supposedly. Right.
right?
So
right.
But you'd only work 4 months out of the year because it was a summer program because you're still going to school. So, you know, my senior year of college with 11 credits left, I basically walked out because I was making four times more than the professors teaching me social dynamics. And I just, you know, started getting into like advanced courses on body language, tonality, those type of things, and got into different careers and, you know, started making multiple seven figures a year as an employee, as a mm-hmm. salesperson. So that's kind of the history. And then retired in 2017 and okay. Didn't know what I was going to do. I have a bunch of real estate, was just kind of setting back. And then I started seeing all these ads, like you talk about, you see my ads, our ads. Mm-hmm. I started seeing all these ads from the sales gurus about mm-hmm. how to sell. And I'm just like, I'm watching them and I'm just like, if I would have sold that way, I would have made like 95% less than what I did. Mm-hmm. And they're like preaching, it's like the gospel. And I'm just right. like, there's, because everybody had told me like, you've got to start your own sales training company. This was even in my second job. They're like, you've got to start your own sales training company. And I never wanted to do it. But like, it just got me thinking like all these people are going this way when they should be going this way. Right. Yep. That's when I jumped in 2018 and. You know, here we are.
Same thing with real estate agents. They start out and all the gurus tell them this pressure way and yeah. it makes all the prospects run away from them.
Right.
And then the top producers realize pretty quickly that that was that they needed to be doing exactly the opposite of yeah. Of what they were taught. Okay. So in 2017, you retire. Literally when you retire, you just don't even know, like you didn't start the sales training career and kind of transition into it. You just retired. I got real estate. And then later,
I didn't know what I was going to do. You know, I read a lot of books and different things. Like I'm a historian too. I'm a weirdo, but I was just kind of hanging out and probably about 4 to 5 months into it, you know, I started seeing ads and then just got kind of bored. And I'm like, there's a market for this. Plus everybody kept telling me like, dude, what are you doing? Like you need to start a sales training company. And hey, the first year was no bueno. It was me and my former assistant for my job, who's my assistant when I was a rep. And I'm like, hey, Beth, do you want to come over and work for me? I'm starting this company. She's like, yay. So it was me and my assistant the first year to about a year and a half. And I think I did 4 webinars. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we made 7 figures, but I think I spent like a lot more than what mm-hmm. we made in the yeah. first year. I think I lost like 600 grand the first year. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, this is awesome. We've got lots of people having success in these industries, but it's not very profitable. I'm losing 600 mm-hmm. grand every year. I'm counting the mouth like, okay, how many? Okay, look, if I keep doing this for the next 8, 9, 10 years, like I'm probably going to have to unretire and go back into my job. So I got to figure this out. And then that's when we started building a real team and got a real CEO, my business partner, Matt Ryder, and also our chief revenue officer is a business partner, Marco Cortese. And they came in about really 2.5 years ago. And you probably don't even know this. Like 2.5 years ago, we probably had like, I don't know, 15 employees. And mm-hmm. now we have almost 150. Mm-hmm. So a lot can change mm-hmm. pretty quick. I didn't even have an Instagram account mm-hmm. until 19 months ago. I'd never okay. been on Instagram at all. And then 19
Well, and that's kind of my thing. I was like, this dude kind of came out of nowhere. It's like you didn't even have an Instagram account. So it all makes sense.
I had nothing. There was nothing there. I was just a salesperson that obviously made a lot of money as a salesperson and had the skills to do that. But then we got the marketing and we just kind of, you know, we went from like ground zero to, you know, millions a month and lots of hundreds of thousands of clients. So it's been good.
So you we're still
learning, trying to get better.
Yeah, of course. So you started out like you created courses. And then you tried to sell them and create webinars.
I created one course. So now we have like 34 courses or something, but I started the first course, I think it was like early 2018 or something like that, and started doing webinars like once every 3 months because I didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
And
how did you get the people to the webinars?
Hired an outside marketing agency to drive traffic, okay, which they didn't do that well. So, and a lot of it was, I just didn't know what I didn't know. Right. So when you hire an outside marketing agency and it's you and your assistant trying to put everything together, I mean, how far are you going to go? So I learned then, very quickly, you have to have the right team around you.
And then what was the turning point? Like you were like, okay, we lost 600 G's. So let's go hire a bunch of people. Like what? Like
I realized I needed to have a team. It's one thing, you know, because in a few of the organizations I was in, you know, I became like a vice president of sales, one very large company that, you know, that's publicly traded. I became a chief sales officer of that company. But it's one thing to be a chief sales officer or VP of sales compared to actually owning the business or being a CEO and running a company, two completely different things. Mm-hmm. I was obviously really good at selling, training salespeople and recruiting salespeople, but a whole different ballgame when you're making decisions that, you know, are hundreds of thousands of dollars sometimes, and then how to implement that, marketing, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So basically we started 2.5 years ago is when we started taking off, you know, started doing really well. And we had an outside marketing agency, but after about 3 or 4 months of even then, we're like, hey, we got to bring this in-house. We got to figure this out. And so basically with Marco Cortese, he was our chief revenue officer. He still is. We're like, you got to figure out marketing. You're a salesperson, but here's a bunch of courses. Take 45 days off and you need to learn how to do this. So he comes back like 2 weeks later. He's like, I think I figured it out. And he's a creative genius and nobody really knew. He's like, I call him the Elon Musk of marketing now. I never met a salesperson that could be so great at sales, but then even better. I just never met somebody that could do both like exceptionally well. Like we're talking like top 1% stuff. And then our ads started going everywhere. And then we started doing reels about 19 months ago. And then that's when I started doing reels on Instagram when I first opened up an IG account.
Yeah. And you're doing great there. So, I mean, because we've got limited time, because I could just continue to dig on this.
I'll go another 15, 20 minutes. We're good.
Yeah. So, how much has social media, because you just started it, basically, you're an infant in the social media world.
Yeah.
How much gasoline did that throw on the fire?
I'd say a lot of gasoline. It helps your ads, obviously. So people who watch are.
So y'all were already running ads before you started throwing out organic.
Yeah.
Content?
I mean, we were already doing, I mean, for a sales training company, we were decently sized even 2.5 years ago. We were doing over 7 figures a month. And for sales training companies, that's really good. I mean, there's not a lot of companies that do sales training that even do 7 figures a month,
a year,
or even a year, right? Like that's even rare. So to even do it in a month, now we're like multiple 7 figures a year, but a month, but it's very rare even to do that like in a month. So we were, before we even started doing reels, we were close to like $1 million a month in sales. Okay. Mm-hmm. But that's like 5x that now, because the reels, like what they do is when people watch the reels for more than 30 seconds, obviously we retarget that person and they start like, probably like you, start seeing ads every time they get on Facebook, every time they get on Instagram. We haven't even really gone into YouTube yet. We just started doing that a couple months ago. Mm-hmm. And we acquired a content creation company that focuses on YouTube. So we're going to blow up our YouTube channel. So we brought that in-house. So, you know, we're still infants in the ball game, but we have a lot of clients that we've got thousands of testimonials, which are, you know, what we're doing it for. And we're growing, you know, trying to figure it out.
What are you guys spending on ads?
You know, the crazy thing is, because we get about a 12x return on our ads. Mm-hmm. So we only spend about $500,000 a month on ads right now. Mm-hmm. Now, we could double that overnight. But the issue is, a lot of companies try to do that, the figured ads. They're like, let's just double it.
Yeah. But
then that breaks their fulfillment. And so in our minds, like, our fulfillment is the number one most important thing, because when individual salespeople or companies, whether it's a Fortune 500 company all the way down to a ma and pa, you know, laundromat or chiropractor to an individual salesperson selling anything, the main thing is we have to get them the results they came for. So if we just doubled our ads and doubled the leads, we're just bringing in so many people that we can't fulfill because we don't have enough sales trainers and myself and who else we have here to actually do the training besides virtual training courses that we have. So we've grown a lot. You know, last year we grew like 500 some percent. Could we have grown 2,000%? Probably, because we have ads figured out. However, what would that do to our brand? You know, we start getting some people that don't get help because we have too many people in our training programs and group training. So we'll never do that. We'll never sacrifice the brand and results just to grow faster because we're already growing probably too fast. So we don't want to like double that. So put the foot on the brake sometimes.
What do you think the, for somebody like what, you basically just started Instagram and you're doing great, right? You're getting 1,000 likes, you're getting hundreds of thousands of views. What's up?
Supposedly we're doing good. I don't know.
You are. I've been doing it for 6 years now.
Oh, have you?
And so I watch all the people and I know the different metrics and everything.
Okay.
I mean, sure. But the thing is like in a year or two, you'll see a dramatic increase. You know, you may be thinking, oh, I'm getting 500 to 1,000 likes now. Yeah. But you know, it's just the consistency that'll snowball over time.
We book a little bit over 4,000 sales calls a month from our ads and from our reels and stuff. So like even like we have, you know, Exxon Mobil is one of our clients now. They actually started following me on Instagram like 4 months ago.
That's crazy, and they became
a client from one of their like their vice president of sales or regional vice president of sales or something, just started following me. And then he got everybody else involved. And all of a sudden I'm like, 2 weeks later, I'm doing a keynote for like all 47 divisions throughout the United States. So,
you know, they're paying you for a keynote, or are you like an ongoing sales trainer for them?
So we do, for them, we did a keynote and then they have access to our virtual training platforms.
And then what exactly are their salespeople selling?
Well, they're selling like oil leases. You've got companies like that have 75 divisions. So they go in, they might be selling different leases to like different individual contract. I don't know. It's kind of weird. They have like contractors that they have to sell to like replace their equipment. They don't just do like oil. They like actually do machinery and equipment and other things as well, which I didn't even know that before we became a client. They do a lot of things.
So you feel like you might not be doing that great on Instagram or on social media. That's the vibe I get.
I feel like we're doing good, but I feel like we, you know, as we go, you learn from do's and don'ts and you get better. I know we're doing much better now than we were a year and a half ago when we first started.
So let's switch over to sales because I really want to nail that part down, right? For the real estate agents watching.
You're asking marketing questions to the guy who doesn't know anything about marketing. I should get my VP of marketing and our CRO on here. They would probably be able to give you metrics that I just don't know.
Sure. But you're making the videos. You're in the camera, right? Sunglasses on. You're talking the talk, right? So sales. Okay. So you know, a lot of real estate agents, like I said, they kind of get led down the wrong path in the beginning. You know, same way you did when you started out door to door. Like take me through like a sales process. You know, not even door to door. We've, you know, what about, let's go with cold calling, right? Yeah. Calling a property owner on the phone. Cause that's how I built my business.
Yeah. The biggest, you want me to show you something cool? Hold on.
Yeah.
Let me show you something cool. So, you know, we have a lot of, we train a ton of real estate agents. I don't know if it's 3,000, 12,000. I have no idea. I just see tons of testimonies for real estate agents, but we also train a lot of real estate investors that call like distressed properties, you know, the 30-day cash thing or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so the biggest thing with cold calling that I see salespeople, real estate agents, or, you know, people who call distressed properties or really any business that colds call is they sound the same. And it's typically like this type of an approach. Is this John? Hey, John, this is Jeremy Miner. I'm with XYZ company. And hey, the reason why I called you was, my name is, I'm with XYZ company. And the reason why I called you was, and they're taught that you got to sound authoritative. You've got to get straight to the point. Prospects don't have time, but that type of technique, it doesn't work 99% of the time. So like, I love when sales trainers are like, oh, like selling is just a numbers game. You just got to call more leads. You got to get more no's that lead to the yes. You just got to work harder. And I'm like, when sales trainers would say that in their books and stuff, when I was a young lad, I'm just like, well, how does that give me any competitive advantage? Like, I'm just going to outwork the other guy and just make more cold calls. Like, basically what that told me in my mind is what they were really saying to me is that what we're training you doesn't really work that well. So you're just going to have to work harder and work more hours. So I'm like, that's not really fair to me. I bought your training. You're saying I just need to work hard. Like, what do I need to say on that call? How do I need to use my tone to get the prospect to let their guard down and open up? So the biggest thing with cold calling or anything is that right when you make, let's just say a cold call, and I'll give you an industry specific example of cold calling for your space, because I've actually wrote these myself and they work exceptionally well. Okay. And so the biggest thing that I find with any industry or your industry in particular is that there's really no training on, like, not just necessarily what to say, but how to say it. How to use your voice, like how to use your tone, because how to use your facial expressions, because even if you're on a call and they can't see you, your facial expression is like the remote control that leads to your tone and how it's perceived. Does that make sense? So like, if I'm just sitting here like this, like stone cold face, I can't really have a curious tone or a confused tone. But if I'm like, if I wrinkle up my face, like I'm not understanding. See, that's a confused tone. My facial expression causes that tone to be able to come out in that way. I always say your face, your expressions, or the remote control to your voice. Okay. So if I'm calling and I sound, if I'm talking too fast, because typically when you're making a cold call or any type of interaction with the prospect, doesn't matter if it's inbound, outbound, cold calling, in person, over the phone, or Zoom, your prospect subconsciously, okay, they can't even help it as a human being, is picking up on your verbal and nonverbal cues based on your tone and what you're saying and or asking that triggers their brain to react in one of two ways. Now, this might be important for everybody to write this down, okay? When I say trigger your brain to react in one of two ways, you want to understand how you're either triggering them to your side or to stay in the status quo. So if you come across salesy. Now, what do I mean by salesy? Like too excited. Now, I don't mean be boring, but if you come across too excited, like you're really enthusiastic that they took the call, okay? You come across needy. You come across especially attached, okay? And you don't understand how to use your tone. You don't understand what questions to ask. What that does in that first 7 to 12 seconds, it triggers in their mind what's called fight or flight mode. You ever heard of fight or flight mode?
Yep.
Everybody's heard of it, but nobody knows what causes it. That's the problem. Now, my background in social dynamics and behavioral science, I know what causes that because it's the part of your brain called the survival part of your brain. A lot of people call it the reptilian part of your brain. So right when you take that call, let me give you an example. When a telemarketer calls you, have you ever noticed that within 5 to 10, maybe 15 seconds, you immediately say, not interested? And then you get off the phone and you don't really know what they were even calling for or talking about.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Now, why does that happen? Because when they come across scripted or excited, that triggers the survival part of your brain. Survival part of your brain's been there for millions of years, whenever God put the first humans on planet Earth, whenever that was. Okay. So what happens is that your voice, like your voice, your tone is what the brain hears first before it can interpret what your words are and what they mean. And I draw this out, but I don't have time. So it goes in your reptilian part of your brain. That's like where they hear the sound, okay? I'll give you an example. This might be easier. Let's say you're at a grocery store in the parking lot and you hear a lady scream like, hey, you're instantly gonna react to that, okay? Your survival part of your brain, your reptilian part of your brain reacts like, am I safe? Like, is somebody gonna shoot me or kill me? What's going on? Instantly triggers that fight or flight. Okay. Am I okay? Like the saber-toothed tiger's behind me. Am I all right? Okay. Then that moves into what's called, and there's different names, but we call it the midbrain. So within about 1 to 2 seconds, that moves into your midbrain where you start to interpret the words that she's saying. Okay. Then within a split second of that, it goes into what's called your neocortex, which is your problem solving part of your brain. You're like, oh yeah, it's just a lady yelling at her daughter to, like, you know, look both ways before she crosses the street. I'm okay. So instantly you react based on the sound, the tone. Then it goes to your midbrain. You start to interpret what the words mean. And then your problem solving part of the brain's like, oh, it's just a lady yelling at the kid to get more strawberries.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's what happens in your brain. So when you're cold calling, if you're like, hi, my name is, I'm with XYZ company, and the reason why I'm calling is, all you're doing is triggering what? You're triggering fight or flight, because how many times has that prospect had a telemarketer call, a cold call that came into their company, where the salesperson sounded very similar with their tone and the words they said? So mm-hmm. instantly you are triggering fight or flight mode by sounding like everybody else. So the biggest thing we have to do is we have to trigger enough curiosity that causes the prospect on the other side of the phone to actually want to engage. Does that make sense? So I'll give you an example of this. Okay. Now, when I do this, you might be like, I'm not understanding, but I'll kind of give you some stats of how this works. So what I always tell real estate agents to do, or people who call distressed properties, you can do it kind of either way. Most counties, you can go print off property tax records of the homes you're calling. That makes sense? Can you do that where you're at?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we get all the data.
Okay. So this is good. So I tell everybody, print, you're about to cold call this homeowner. So, you know, I'll give you an example. I'll stay on the investor side, and maybe we'll have time to do for real estate agent side. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's say you've got these property tax records. You're about to call this property. I always tell the rep to like print them off in their hands, because as they're talking, I want them to thumb through it where the other person can hear the paper.
Okay.
Why do I want them to hear the paper? Because it triggers curiosity.
Okay.
Okay, because it sounds real. It doesn't sound like a cold call. If you don't have them printed off your hand, sounds like a cold call. So they might answer the phone. I'm dead serious. It's like, it's a pattern interrupt.
Yeah.
So to trigger curiosity, I have to change I have to interrupt their pattern. Okay. If I can't interrupt the pattern, I don't trigger curiosity. So they might say, hey, this is the Jones family. Yes. Is Edward there? Yeah, Edward, it's just, Jeremy Minor with XYZ. I'm holding a copy of your property taxes for your property at 55 Willow Lane. And I was wondering if you could possibly help me out for a moment. Now, what do you think the prospect's going to say? I'm holding a copy. Let me do this again. Yeah, I'm holding a copy of your property tax records of your home at the 55 Willow Lane property. And I was wondering if you could possibly help me out for a moment. What do you think most people are going to say there? Well, who is this again?
They're going to continue.
My property taxes? Like,
okay. Yeah, they're going to be thinking, how did you get my property taxes?
Yes.
What are you doing with them?
What I automatically did was trigger curiosity. Now, there's a second part of that I'm going to show you. So automatically trigger curiosity. You will, if you do that with kind of the tone I used, you see I slowed down. Now, if I was like, yeah, is this the Johnsons? Hey, John, I'm holding a copy of your property taxes. I'm with XYZ Realty. And I was wondering if you could help me out for a moment. See, that sounds super fast, super salesy, like a normal salesperson. They're not even hearing what I said because they have no time to process what I'm saying. So I have to slow down. I'm going to do it again. And I'm going to do it in what I call a confused tone. Now, a lot of people, when they're like, they first hear this, like, you should not ask confused on a cold call. You got to show them that you're in charge and that you're an expert. And I'm like, I agree, but every salesperson does that when they cold call. Now, am I going to sound confused a minute in? No, but I have to trigger curiosity in the beginning. And a confused tone is so your tone is how your prospect interprets why you're asking the question. So your tone is how they interpret the intention behind what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm confused, typically when somebody's confused, you do what?
How you want to help them.
You want to help. See, I'm working with human behavior rather than working against it. I was wondering if you could, sure, how can I help you? Or what's this all about? Or who are you with again? Well, and I'm not even sure it even makes sense for us to talk, but I represent a group of, we don't want to say investors. I represent a group of, I have a term for it that we always use. Damn it. What is that? What's another term for investor? Give it to me.
Buyers.
Yeah, we could use buyers. You could, I mean, whatever you want to say. I know there's a term. It'll come to my mind. We don't say investors.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, and I'm not even sure. See, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to downplay it. Where I'm not, I don't want to put sales pressure. So I'm going to downplay. Well, and I'm not even sure if it makes sense for us to talk, but I represent a group. That's what it is. A group who's buying about 4 to 5 different properties on like a 3-block area by your Willow Lane property. And I was thumbing through your property tax records on that. I called to see if you guys would be opposed to having a brief conversation around that. Okay. And I just stopped. Now, why would I say, would you be opposed to having a brief conversation around that? Why wouldn't I say, would you be open to having a brief conversation around that? Why would I say opposed rather than open?
Because they want to say no.
Oh, so you maybe saw this somewhere before I've done this. Okay. Because I don't, unless you're one of our clients, you wouldn't know that. We don't really talk about this on reels and stuff like that. So I want them to say no, because on a cold call, they're conditioned to want to say no. It's hard for them to say, yes, I'm opposed. It's very hard. You know what they say? Sure. What do you have in mind? Or sure, I can talk for a couple minutes, and right then and there, I'm engaged in a two-way conversation. Yeah, I'm not even sure if it makes sense for us. See how I'm downplaying it? I'm like pushing them away. I'm not even sure if it even makes sense for us to talk. That's the first part of that. Now, why would I say that? Why wouldn't I be like, I'm so excited. I have some people that really want to buy your home. Why wouldn't I say that?
Well, just to let them know that this is a two-way, they have a decision. Like it's their decision if they want to continue.
Well, it is, but see, I'm pushing back. And human behavior, when you push back on a sales call, like you're pushing them away, people typically think you have something important.
Human nature, they just want to push back. If you're pushing, they want to push back.
See, I don't want to push them. I want to push them away where they pull me back in.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? It's the push-pull dynamic. I don't want to push where they push back. I'm just kind of pushing them away. I want them to, I'm downplaying, like I'm not even sure if we should even be talking, right? So I'm downplaying. I'm not negative, but I'm not ultra positive. I'm right in the middle. I'm neutral. I have more of an unbiased tone, if that makes sense. I'm collective. Okay, I'm collective. I'm still assertive at this point. Yeah, and I'm not even sure if it makes sense for us to talk, but I represent a group who's actually going to be buying about 4 to 5 different properties. There's like a 4-block area, like right by your Willow Lane property. And as we were thumbing through like your property tax records on that property, I called to see if you guys would be opposed to having a brief conversation around that, because we might have something for you. Would you be opposed to talk about that? Something like that. I can angle that. Now, we can also do that for buyers. I represent a group of buyers. See, it's the same thing. There's just little tweaks there we'd use for like a real estate agent who might be calling like an expired list of homeowners who listed it themselves. And there's little tweaks there, but that cold calling right there, according to the data we have from the companies that use that, we have a 72.1 or 72.3% rate that conversation after they say hello is going to go at least 10 minutes to book. Mm-hmm. And let me know if any cold calling script you used before has a 72% rate of lasting 10 minutes into a booking.
Mm-hmm.
Not going to happen. Those are the people that answer. Obviously there's people that don't, most people don't answer, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we do voicemails like that too. Voicemails are like, yeah, I'm just leaving a message for Carrie Ann. I'm holding a copy of your property taxes on your home at 55 Willow Lane. And I was wondering if you could possibly help me out for a moment. I'll be here in the office for just a few hours today. You can reach me at 555-655. And like I said, if I don't answer, just leave a message and I should be able to get back to you later today on the property. You know how many people call back from that?
A lot.
Holding a copy. Of, yeah.
Yeah. That's good, man.
There you go. There's a lot more to that. There's, you know, what do you say if they say, well, you know, this or that? There's different ways. We teach all that in our virtual training platforms. But that's just an example of how to trigger curiosity where you get the prospect to let their guard down. We call that how do you disarm the prospect where they let their guard down and they want to engage and actually open up to you. And if you can't do that, you know, there's no
secret. You're just every other agent.
You're just like anybody else calling them every day and they just treat you the same. You have to chase them, follow up. Like, I'd rather not do all that work. I'd rather just focus on the, I always say, focus on the skills game Whereas most of you have been trained that you focus on the numbers game. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's just crazy. It's like Steph Curry. You watch NBA?
Mm-hmm.
It's like Steph Curry saying that basketball is a numbers game. Just shoot as many threes as you can. You know, you'll hit one here and there.
Yeah.
Just a numbers game. Just throw it up as many times as you can. I mean, if he had that attitude, he would have never made his high school varsity basketball team. See, Steph knows that basketball is a skills game. See, he's focused on his technique and improving that technique day in and day out. Imagine what salespeople would be like if they focused on the words they're saying, if they focused on the questions they're asking, if they focused on what do I need to do differently because I'm getting this objection over and over. What am I saying or not asking that's triggering them to say I want to do more research? What am I saying and not asking that's triggering them to say I want to think it over? Okay, so how do you prevent those objections from happening? How do I use my tone to get them to let their guard down? If they focused on the skills game, guess how many calls they'd have to make?
Yeah,
way down here. And every person they talk to is likely to, not every person, but far higher percentage of chance, you know, instead of this percentage, maybe you quadruple your percentage of closings and listings and those type of things. So many salespeople have been brainwashed. You got to focus on the numbers, that they just go through the motions and they never increase their skill level of what they're saying to the prospect, what they're asking and how they're using their tone. And that's where the sale's made.
Yeah.
I never understood that. I'd rather work far less and make four times as many sales than the guy or girl that's working 14 hours a day just playing the numbers game. Ugh, gross.
It's so important, bro. And like 85 to 90% of agents fail in the first couple of years, right? Yeah. Real stats.
Yeah.
And it's literally because of that right there, because agents will say, I've been making calls months and months, you know, and I've got nothing. I'm like, well, it's not the people you're calling. Yeah. Right. It's you. Like, we have to work on your tone and your delivery and your communication and everything else. Well, why don't you think that that what you're talking about is more of a widespread? Why isn't there more training on this versus it seems like the most widespread mainstream coaching and sales training is more the opposite, right?
Well, I mean, can tell you why. Because if you don't have a background in the way the brain works and behavioral science and social dynamics, you wouldn't know anything I just said. It wouldn't make sense to you. It's not like you wake up one day and you're like, I need to trigger curiosity. How do I get them to let their guard down? How do I use my tone to cause them? How do I use verbal pacing in this question to pace it out where it triggers them to emotionally open up? You wouldn't know that unless you had a background in behavioral science. You just wouldn't know that. Like if I went to college, and let's say I was, trained as a business finance manager or a business manager or like anything outside of what I'm talking about, you wouldn't know. You just don't know what you don't know. And so I find that sales trainers are just transactional. Not everybody. I mean, I've got some friends that I think are exceptionally great sales trainers that would have more of my background. But there's very few that really studied social dynamics, human behavior, or really understand what those concepts even mean. You ever read a book by Oren Claff called How to Pitch Anything? So Oren, either, I don't know if he went to school for that or he studied that a lot after, but when he talks about status framing, authority framing, power framing, you're actually taught those concepts in social dynamics when you go to school, just so you know. They actually call it rank framing instead of status framing, because what does your rank signify? So from ancient cultures all the way back to what we have record on till now, in ancient cultures, the way they saw the way your status was either a lowered status or a higher status was basically by your tattoos on your arms and like the clothes you wore. That was like a status thing, right? You had higher status or lowered status. Now, salespeople in society at large, what type of status are they viewed at society at large?
Low.
Very low status, right? Mm-hmm. Because of the way they've been taught how to sell, the pushiness, the high pressure, it just triggers that reaction from society in large. So you already have a disadvantage when you get into that sales conversation. Mm-hmm. So what we train salespeople to do, instead of getting on a sales call, let's say if it's an inbound lead that books on your calendar, like, hey, how are you doing today? How's it going over there? How's the weather? Oh, it's so great. Yes. Did you watch the game last night? Basically, most prospects know when you start off with those type of questions that you genuinely are not interested in really how their damn day's going. Let's just be real. Okay. Even if you are, because I've had sales like, no, Jeremy, you don't understand. I am always really interested in my prospect's day. I'm like, well, you might be interested. And I'd be highly suspicious that you're interested in every single lead that you talk Tuesday and how it's going. I'd be highly suspicious if you really are. Mm-hmm. Prospects don't believe you are. Now, once they become a client, that's different. But if you start making cold calls or like outbound leads, hey, how you doing today? How's it going over there, John? Like, you're automatically triggering a lowered status. Why? Because every salesperson's ever tried to sell them anything from a vacuum cleaner to a life insurance policy to a house to, you know, a boat to cybersecurity for their offices starts off with the same predictable, how are you doing type of questions. So all you're doing is you're lowering your status because they now view you like what? Like every other salesperson they've ever talked to. And you probably don't want that. All right. So there's different ways to relanguage that that makes you stand out and sound different than using traditional phrases like, I'm just following up with you. I know we talked a couple months ago. I'm just checking in. I'm just following up. How many of those emails do you get where they say, I'm just following up with you? Mm-hmm. You read much past those words?
What's that?
Do you ever read those emails?
No.
I'm just following up with you. I'm just checking back in.
I delete them.
You know why? Because the other
email, I know what it's going to be.
Because they're triggering that by using those type of words that every salesperson uses. Okay. I'm just checking in. I'm just following up. So those are words that trigger the prospect to go into fight or flight mode. So you want to stay away from words that every salesperson always uses, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I digress.
Bro, thank you so much for coming on and letting us get to know you a little bit. Where can everybody follow you and all that good stuff?
Yeah, you know, the best place they could, you know, they follow us on Instagram or something. You can look up our Instagram handle, Jeremy Lee Miner. Make sure you follow the verified account. There's, I don't know, 520 or 30,000 followers on that. I'm not sure. And then if they want like some tips and more like little gold nuggets, because I know we didn't have time to go through those, they're welcome to join one of our free Facebook groups. We'll give you a link. Have them go to, let's send them to this one, salesrevolution.pro. So have them go to salesrevolution.pro. There's 80 some thousand salespeople in there. There's a ton of real estate agents I know that are in there because I see testimonials. And we go live in there two or three times a week, different subject matters, different trainings. So they can go there for free. And then they're welcome to get one of our books here. This is called The New Model of Selling, Selling to an Unsellable Generation. It's a Wall Street Journal, Amazon bestseller as well, Barnes & Noble bestseller. So if they get the book, my only request is that they buy it from barnesandnoble.com because we have a huge deal with Barnes & Noble. So it's going to cost you about 35 more cents to buy it on Barnes & Noble over Amazon. So buy it from barnesandnoble.com. Just type in The New Model and you're welcome to get that book. This book, we put a lot of tactical training in it, not just theory. I'd always get pissed off when I'd read sales books that would just recycle 10 different theories, 10 different ways. And I would read the book and I'm like, I absolutely learned nothing from this book. So we put in a lot of different examples in there, questions to ask and why you're asking them and how to get the prospect to let their guard down. So they're welcome to get this book at barnesandnoble.com or any Barnes & Noble bookstore.
Sweet. I'm going to link all that below the group, your, the Facebook group, your Instagram, and the Barnes & Noble link. So they can go straight there. So all those will be down below, man. And go follow my boy here. Good to see you, man.
Hey, thanks for having me on your show. I wish I had more time with you, but this is a this is one of the craziest days I've ever had. I'm like, I'm back to back to back, like every 30 minutes. Crazy.
We'll do it again real soon.
Okay. Thanks, Ricky. I appreciate it.
Thank you, bro. See you, man.